about that. Coach S loves this slide. A lot of people in the athletic world love this. Everybody has a plan until they get punched in the mouth. Usually what that means is you go out and play a football game. You're an offensive guy. The defensive guy across from you is bigger and stronger than you. All of a sudden, everything you thought about how good you were might change first hit when he pancakes you, right? So what we're talking about is there's certain things that are going to punch you in the mouth if you're not ready for them, prepared for them as we go through this. Grades, SATs and ACTs, college entrance exams, and life in general, okay? They're going to be the things that are going to take care of your dreams. So we're trying to prepare you so you can go through school and keep the doors open. Anybody know who this is?
Just you.
Not me. Here's the guy. This is the guy that got to decide whether or not Coach Anders played for the Kansas City Chiefs. He got the vote. How about this one? That's the coach that got the vote to decide whether or not Coach Anders got to play for the University of Houston. You see a pattern? What's that mean?
Zero.
Yes, zero. That's how many votes you, your family, all your friends get on whether or not you're good enough to play either in the NFL, college football, or anything that you want to do. You don't get a vote. Makes sense? It's other people that get to vote. So today we're talking about one of the people that get to vote, and that's the NCAA. If you decide you want to go play Division I, Division II, or Division III, you're not going to get to vote on whether or not you qualify. You can do the work, then these people get to decide whether or not you're good enough. So what we're going to talk to you about today is what's expected of you, what you have to do to look good to them so they can vote yes. So we'll start off with the NC2A Division I. These are all the big schools, the LSUs, the Alabamas, the ones that everybody wants to play for, UT, A&M. These are all the big dog schools, okay? There's three words you need to know: qualifier, academic redshirt, and non-qualifier. Qualifier means you meet all the guidelines to play and get some money. Academic redshirt means you're probably good enough to play, but you don't get to, you only get to practice. Non-qualifier means you don't make the cut. And this is all based on grades and test scores. Notice there's nothing up there that says you're a good athlete. Most schools don't care. Until you're a student first, athlete second. So it's really important to remember, you have to be a student first, athlete second. You can have all the talent in the world, but if you can't meet these academic guidelines we're going to talk about, it's not going to make a difference. So here's some of the academic requirements. First of all, you have to graduate from high school on time. High school cannot be the toughest 5 or 6 years of your life. You have to get done in 4 years or less. They're going to look at 16 courses, and I'll show you what those courses are in a minute. They're going to look at 16 courses. They're going to look at the grades you earn in those courses. You have to hit a certain GPA. We'll talk about that. And then you're going to take college entrance exams, two of them. You take either the SAT or the ACT. You can take both, but there's certain numbers you have to hit. Without those numbers, you're not going to make the cut. Division I wants to see that you have a 2.3 GPA out of the 16 core courses. Then they have a sliding scale. The higher your GPA is, that means the better grade you get in class, the higher your GPA, the worse you can do on these ACTs and SATs. So if you do bad in class, then you have to score really, really high on these SATs and ACTs to make the cut. It makes sense to me to focus on doing really, really well in school, getting high grades, because it makes your life easier. And again, you have to graduate on time. So they're looking for a 2.3. We'll talk about that in a second. If you want to be an academic redshirt and you just want to go to college, and let's say that they all say, yeah, you're good enough to play on our team, but you don't qualify academically to actually play, then you're going to take the first year off. They let you practice, but they don't let you play.
Is that for all 4 years, or is that 1 year?
No, it'll change. Typically, I believe that academic redshirt is for the first year. And then you have to start making your grades in college because you have to be eligible in college. But I don't talk much about that because they have their whole set of own rules up there when you're in school. You have to actually make grades. GPA, you have to get more than 70s. I know everybody says, I just have to get a 70 so I can play. It's not going to make a difference unless you can get to 2.3. So here's the courses they count. Most people, everybody's in here is freshman, correct? So they're going to count 4 years of English. They're going to count 3 years of math, 2 years of science, 2 years of social studies. Then they're going to go and look at an additional English credit, a math credit, or science credit. And then they're going to throw some other classes in there, which include foreign languages. So when you're sitting in your Spanish class, or your German class, or your Chinese class, you need to pay attention to those grades because they can help you. Here's a list of classes. The ones in green are required for graduation. You're going to take these classes. You can see English 1, English 2, English 3, and English 4. What surprised me when I went to the Eligibility Center and looked at the NCAA approved classes is speech is on there. Speech is a class, if you just show up, give 3 speeches, and do your work, you're going to get a 90 or to 100. It's easy to pass it. If you get a 70 in the speech class, you're wasting an opportunity. Make sense? So, you have to do well in English 1, you have to do well in English 2, English 3. Speech class is an opportunity to get a high grade. Math-wise, you can see you're going to choose between Algebra 1 and Geometry. Those are the 2 required classes, and then you can start picking 2 more credits. It can either be Algebra 2, Pre-Cal, or Stats. Notice it can't be Math Models, so it can't go down and be the easy class to get an A in. It has to be one of these more difficult classes. So typically, you're going to go Algebra, Geometry, Algebra 2, possibly Pre-Cal. Same way in science, you have to take biology. You can choose between IPC, chemistry, or physics in your second year. And then you take 2 more credits that they're going to look at. Social studies. One of the things that I understand about social studies, if you look at the people who teach them, most of them are
coaches.
So you would think that if you sat in their class, did their work, learned what you were supposed to do, behaved, took their test, passed their test, they probably could find a way to get you an 80. Because you're going to deserve it, right? But if you go in and screw up, you're probably going to get 70. You're screwing yourself. Because there again is an opportunity to work on people who like you. Okay, so pay attention to your social studies classes. And then you have all your foreign language classes. Coach Garza, would you agree if they sit in your class, do your work, pass your test, come to tutoring if they need to, are they going to get an 80 or are you just going to give them 70? It's not hard. You have to pay attention, do your thing. Don't make your teachers mad. Work with them. Do your work. Behave yourself. Okay, GPA is a mathematical thing. The way it works is they look at your grade. If it's a 70, they're going to give you 2 points. If it's an 80, they're going to give you 3 points. And for every 90 you get, they're going to give you 4 points. Then you're going to multiply times credits. There's 2 ways to do it. You can do it by the semester. You can do it by the overall grade when they average out. But essentially, you're just going to do this math. You're going to take the total number of points you have. So you're going to take the grade, convert it to points, multiply times credits, add them all up, and then you're going to divide it by your credits. And that's going to give you a grade point average. Typically, when I look at a transcript, if I see a kid has a 2.3 GPA, I know most of his classes are in the mid-70s. That's what it means. Okay? If you're taking pre-AP and AP level classes, you get a little bit more GPA points for them. I can't tell you exactly because I was looking on the website trying to figure it out, and I couldn't figure it out. They didn't make that clear. But you can get some more points. So the higher grades you get in your pre-AP and your AP classes, the better off you're going to be. Now notice if you get a 90, you get 4 points. If you get a 70, you get a 2. If you take 4 plus 2, you get what? 6 most days. And divide that by 2, what do you get? 3. That's good, because that's the same thing as getting an 80. So if you do get a 70, just work real hard to get a 90 to balance it out. Make sense? Okay, so there's 16 courses they look at, there's 32 semester grades. What I did was I put all 70s there. So I had 32 twos there, and I get 64 points. When you divide that by 16, when you do it the right way, I mean, you divide by 32, you're not going to get your 2.3. So I started adding 80s in there to figure out how many 80s I needed to get me to where I needed to be. It turns out of those 32 semester classes, 10 of them need to be 80s. There'd have to be an 80 in every class, at least 10 of them, as you go through. sense? You don't have to be perfect in every class. You're going to have some strength. You're going to have a speech class. You're going to have a history class you really like. You get along with the teacher. You're going to have a math class you do well in. So you don't have to be perfect in every class. You have to be good at some of the classes and get at least 10 of those. And every 90 helps turn one of those 70s, just like we just talked about. So your job is to manage your grades. The way you manage your grades is show up to class, be in class, don't be out of class, do your work, don't talk with your neighbors, do your work, pass the test, go to tutoring, whatever it takes to get 80s. Okay, once we figure out your GPA, then we look at this thing called a sliding scale. And this is to tell you what your score has to be on an ACT or an SAT. You usually take those, I say, in the first part, the first time you take them, is usually the spring of your junior year. You really want to have Algebra 2 underneath your belt. You also want to have English 2, because that's basically what's tested. There's not much more tested than those two subjects. The ACT has four sections to it. One of it's science. Most of it's graphs. Can you read a graph? But they do reading, writing, arithmetic, every test. SAT has 10 sections to it. It skips around, gives you shorter amounts of time. Has less questions because it's a problem-solving test. So if you're a good problem solver, the SAT might be for you. The ACT has four sections to it that they score. Reading, writing, math, science. There's more questions on it, and it's more of a memorization test. So if you're a good memorizer, you can see stuff, you know, right triangles, you're going to blow through the math section pretty easy, because that's pretty much all they do. If you can look at a graph, you know where the y-intercept is. Am I copying foreign language? Okay, if you know all that stuff, you can see stuff just like you're going to do well on an ACT. I recommend taking both of them. If you qualify for free or reduced lunch, we will give you waivers to pay for each of these tests twice. So if you're economically disadvantaged, it works in your favor. I'll give you a waiver, pays for the SAT. I'll give you a waiver to pay for the ACT. You take them both in the spring of your junior year, you find out which one your brain likes best. You spend the entire summer getting better at it, take it again in the fall, get a big number. That's all it takes. It's really not a hard process at all. Okay, if you have a 2.3, you see that your summation score on your ACT has to be a 75. If you do the math, it's about 19 on average. So your composite score has to be about a 19 or a 20. That's not that difficult to hit. College benchmarks say that you, a 23 or a 22 on an ACT says you're ready to take college classes. So it's not even as high as a typical college benchmark score. Okay? On the SAT, there's only two things they add together. You have to have 450 in each of them, or you can have 500 in one, 400 in the other. You just have to add together. Nothing says you can't start studying for an SAT and ACT now. All the training is online for free. You can find plenty of ACT and SAT prep. There's even classes after school now that'll do it, give you big, thick books. You can practice, practice, practice. You can see that the lower your GPA is, the higher your SAT and ACT score. You're just digging yourself a hole. So if you want to be at 2.0, get straight 70s, you're going to have to score higher than these SATs and ACTs. These tests are not that easy. So you really want to focus on the classwork because you have a teacher there that can help you get higher grades. You can go to tutoring and not have to rely or have your dream die because you can't do an ACT or an SAT. That's why it's important to do well in class. Good news, too. If you take the test more than once, they're going to take your best scores. So there's different sections. They'll take different sections, add things together. So hopefully they call this super scoring for the most part. They take the best score that you have, and they try to make you look as good as possible. They all want you to play in the other town. They're trying to find ways to get you on the field to play. Okay, how about Division II? It's a little bit easier. They just basically are lowering the bar. So if you want to play D2, the 16 core courses are going to be made up of a little bit different stuff. Your GPA can be a little bit lower. And your SATs and ACTs can be a little bit lower. I say, strive for the highest mark, try to get over the highest bar. Worst case, you might hit the second one. If you shoot with the second one, you might end up in the third level. That's not good. Make sense? If you shoot for a 10-0 season and you end up 9-1, that's pretty good. But if you shoot for 5-5 and end up 6-4, that's not. Or 4-6, I guess kind of flipped around, that's not good. So set the bar high, shoot for the best you can do, and then everything else will work out for you. Because you can still go D2, D3, if you qualify D1. Makes sense, because D1 is the hardest one to get. So again, it's the same stuff. You either fully qualify, you partially qualify, or you just don't qualify at all.
Talking about a full qualifier, can you explain exactly what that is, that actually gets you an opportunity to go to college or not?
In terms of, you have to hit the GPA,
yeah.
You have to finish high school, you have to do well on SATs and ACTs, and then somebody's got to think you're a halfway decent athlete. That's what I would think a fully qualifier is.
So my point here is, don't go by some athletic ability. You don't even know the progress, you get the best parents in Texas, you will not be going to college. So if you want school, you don't need that first one.
And a lot of kids will say, well, I'll transfer, but then the transfer rules get in your way too. Because I think you have to sit stuff out, much of, so it's not really worth it. You want to do the best you can. It's not that hard to get high grades. There's a lot of people here that support you. All your teachers will support you. And again, there's a sliding scale in Division II. One thing that Coach Silliman pointed out earlier today was if you go D1, you can get full ride scholarships where they'll pay you everything because you're an athlete. Once you get down into Division II and Division III, then they may give you partial scholarships. And then it's your academics to determine how much more money they give you. And if you're not good on the academic side, you may not have enough money to go to the school that says they really want you to play because you don't have the money to afford to go to college. So it's really important, again, to focus on the academics because that's going to help you get the money you need to go to school. Make sense? Are you catching on to the theme about how important school is?
Yeah.
Okay. And behavior. And then there's Division III. They really don't, they all make up their own rules in Division III. So then it's just a matter of what school you want to go to, what their rules for admission are, whether or not you can make the cut. I like to tell students, it's really easy to go to the schools you think you're interested in. It's really easy to go to the I'm a freshman admission eligibility requirement page. It's also easy to email coaches, go college visiting in your junior and senior year, find out what they're looking for, whether or not they like you, whether or not you're academically or where they need to be. You can do a lot of planning. You just have to sit, instead of playing video games, actually do some planning online and look at the colleges, talk to your counselors, stuff like that, so we can kind of lay a plan out for you.
Is Division III like JUCO?
No. Junior colleges are kind of like different. I went to an NAIA school a long time ago, and I played football for them. So Division III now is kind of like a smaller version of big schools. So it's most of them are private schools. They're not that big. My college only had maybe 1,300 to 1,400 kids in it. So it was like a big high school where I went to college. So it was easy to play football because nobody tried out. I didn't like it. Something else happened, made me play. I was glad it was over. But the nice thing about that is because I played football at that school, it gave me money. I mean, my parents were poor, so I grew up poor. So when I went to school there, the reason that I could go is because I did play football. They found work study jobs for me. They found grants. They found other opportunities for me to be able to make enough money to go to school there. And the school cost like $25,000 a year to go to school. And when I came out, I had hardly any debt whatsoever because I worked out all the way through school. Because of see, and that's what will happen when you go D3, is you have to make sure that there's enough money there for you to play. Okay, so this is the whole planning process. It's never too early to start planning, figure out what kind of grades you need to get, what school you might want to go to, what kind of team they have, who they're looking for. And this applies to any sport, really. It doesn't matter if you're playing football, baseball, basketball, soccer. We consider that a sport. Because it was raining, they didn't want to practice outside. That supports that. And then as we go through, I'll tell you how to report scores. So as we go through, we meet with you, and we can tell you different things, so we can talk to your counselor about all this stuff. Your coach can tell you how to set yourself up in the eligibility center. You can talk to your counselors. Here's my final thought. So the better you are as a student, as a person, and as an athlete, right, the better you are in all three of those areas, the easier it is for people to it's going to be easy for a college to say, yeah, we'll take this guy. He's a good athlete, he's a good student, and he's an all-around great person.